my parents were like, watch David Attenborough. I was like, oh,
yeah. You know that picture that came out that was like the very ill polar bear that was like walking on ice? And it was like, when people saw that picture, they were all of a sudden like, oh, global warming is real or whatever. This documentary is like that picture times 20. And it's just kind of what everyone needs to see, I feel like, to take it seriously. But the cool thing about it, like, you watch it and you're like, wow, we're all so fucked. Like, this is so dark. And then you keep watching, and then it goes into how we can reverse it and how we can make it better. And I feel like that story is never told as much about global warming, like that we can get it back. And so that was a really cool kind of twist to that documentary that I wasn't expecting. That gave me hope, because I was literally watching it and I was like, nobody ever talks about, like, I didn't even know that we could, like, I knew we could stop it, but I didn't know that we could get things back. I don't know.
Yeah.
It was cool. You should watch it.
It's something that I grew up with massively being a talking point. My parents built an off-grid, like, sustainable house, and they have all their own vegetables, and they make their own fuel out of old chip fat from like local companies and stuff. Yeah, so they're like really right on about it. So I've always been around that kind of idea that we're not completely ruined. But I think, yeah, it is a commonly held idea that, like, well, we're fucked. Like, oops. Guess I'll just keep buying everything in plastic and going on a bunch of holidays.
Yeah,
good on David. Thanks, David.
I know, he's like 95 years old or something.
I should ask if he'll do this. Imagine.
That would be huge. I mean, he's like such a big celebrity in my eyes.
I mean, I don't know what I would even ask him, because I couldn't ask him what I've been asking other people, like, would you rather have a big tongue or like a big nose? He'd be like,
you could just have him on. Yeah, you could just have him on and be like, all right, just talk to me.
Tell me.
Like, you just talk. Yeah.
Monologue time. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I'm really excited that we are getting a chance to chat.
Yeah, thanks for having me in the tub.
I always spend like the day before I interview someone listening to their stuff and watching all their sessions. But it puts me in a really strange headspace where I'm like, feel like a super fan. And then I get really uncomfortable seeing someone in the flesh. I'm like, oh my God, they're here. Even though that's like part of one.
And then you still do it like the week after. Yeah.
Every fucking time.
You're like,
time.
This is awkward. And then next week you're like, I better do it again.
You're like, well, I wonder why I'm so weird.
Oops. That's really funny.
So yeah, thank you for being in the bath. Shall I start? Can I start asking you some stuff?
Yeah, go for it.
No. No.
Actually, I gotta go.
I guess I'm gonna do what every fucking interviewer does and start from the beginning.
Okay.
Let's do this chronologically. I think about being a kid a lot, especially at the moment, because I feel like I wish I was less conscious of everything that's going on right now. And to be a child would help with that. Just to be like, mommy, hold me.
Yeah.
So when you were a kid, did you have a clear idea of what you would be when you were older? Were you one of those kids with vision where you were like, I'm going to be a nurse and I'm going to start doing that right now?
I mean, yeah, I wanted to do this like as long as I can remember, as long as I ever wanted to do anything. But also like I grew up in like different towns in Minnesota, and it was just seemed like, I don't know why I thought it was possible, but I guess I'm glad I did, because it is, but just incredibly unreachable. Like, there was nobody that was playing in bands or doing anything really. But yeah, this was my dream since I was like five. This, and then I really love animals, duh, like everybody, but like probably maybe like a vet would have been my backup or something.
Yeah. So if there was no one doing, I guess, I mean, I grew up rurally and there were, like, no gigs. Like, just live music wasn't a thing.
No.
Was there, like, did you just kind of buy NME and, like, listen to radio and go, like, ooh, that'll be sick? Or were there, like, some musicians doing some stuff?
No, there was no, we were doing any stuff. It's so funny because in interviews they'll be like, what, like, cool music did you listen to growing up? Or, like, were you, like, did you know about, like, the cool musician, like, the cool music Minneapolis scene? I'm like, dude, I didn't know shit. Like, I had the radio, and that was fucking it. I mean, I did. I was blasting Alanis Morissette, like, big time as a seven-year-old. I was like, fuck yeah. But, no, I mean, I just, like, loved singing. But I couldn't really sing well, or, like, I mean, I have my own style of doing it, but when you just have the radio, you kind of compare it to, like, Kelly Clarkson or something, and you're like, yeah, I can't sing that way. Yeah. But I remember when I was, like, really little, I had this friend named Nicole, and she had a really good voice, and I would write little melodies and lyrics and then give them to her to sing and kind of, like, direct it, like, produce it. And that is one of my earliest memories of, like, actively being like, well, is this how it happens? I don't know, but I've got these lyrics and I got Nicole Truxas and she's great.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
And do you have a bachelor in recording?
I have a bachelor's of science in audio engineering.
So was it always interesting to you how music was made and also to make it? Because for me, I've never even thought about producing or how to get the best out of someone musically, apart from myself.
Yeah, I mean, to be completely honest, that just seemed like my only way in to be able to play, because pretty much my public school, there was a zoo school down the street, which is exactly what you think. It was a school on the zoo campus. It was very bizarre, but it was like the art school. But you could kind of go there and take electives your junior and senior year. And so there was this recording class, and I was like, thrilled. Like, obviously I'm going to take this. And if you see, there's pictures of my report card right there. And it's just like D, D, C, bad attitude, poor attitude. And then it's like this streak of straight A's. And that's from that class. And the class was incredibly rudimentary. It was like, here's a microphone. And like, here's Logic. Here's GarageBand. Here's how you can like put a loop into the system and then sing over it. But I was obsessed with it and just was there all the time. I would skip my other classes and go there. And so the teacher there was the one who found MTSU, because I had an awful GPA, and that was the only thing I had any interest in. So he found MTSU, which, like, you can get in. I mean, there's a 47% graduation rate, if that tells you anything about the college. But the audio engineering program was really awesome. And you actually have to, like, get candidacy to get in there. So, like, you have to apply to get in that program after your first 2 years of doing all your fundamental classes. But, so he found that, and I was like, okay, cool. Well, if I can, you know, keep going with engineering, then I can keep kind of writing down little songs to sing to. And so I ended up going there. And then when I got there, everyone was in bands, and all we did on the weekends was go to house shows. That was just like what we did all throughout college. So as soon as I got there, everybody was playing together, and that kind of took off from there.
I'm actually so jealous that it was just immediately apparent to you what your thing was.
I think about that all the time, because I have a number of friends who just, or a lot of people who just don't know, and then they kind of go through the motions of, oh, and now we go to school and now we do this because that's what the system pushes us to do, even though it's like everyone should wait until they know what they want to study, because then we're all in a ton of debt with like something that we're not even passionate about. And I very often am like, wow, I feel very lucky for that, because I feel for those, like, the people who there wasn't anything immediately that they wanted to do. I don't know, because, yeah, that was, like, the only thing, that was, like, that goal or, like, that dream or whatever is what kept me going, like, through everything. And especially being a shitty student and stuff, it was like, well, I still want to get to this place. I still want to get there. I still have to, like, keep going. Mm-hmm. And that, just having that alone to, like, kind of, you know, keep me going and motivated is, I feel really thankful for that, just because that did a lot for me. But yeah, it's super weird being in that, or not being in that position, but kind of, but also to give myself a little credit, like, also going to school for audio engineering and stuff is like, and to play music is, I obviously had to work my ass off to do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you want to do anything like that, or like photography or an art major, you have to be so passionate to make it happen, because it's not like there's jobs for that. I mean, there are, but like so few and far between. So
it really irritates me that the education system is kind of laid out to seem as if doing anything artistic in any capacity is kind of like an easy topic. Like, I remember telling somebody what I was studying at GCSE, and they were like, oh, art and music must be pretty sweet. And I was like, fuck no, it's really a lot of emotional work and a lot of practical work, and it's not, it shouldn't be chosen as an easy way out. And
yeah. I had so many people tell me to drop out of that program. Like, so many. Even before going, I remember my friend, like, sitting me down in high school. She was, like, a year older than me and acted like my mom. She's like, I just don't think you're going to be able to find a job after this. And I was like, okay, well, I'm not going to be able to find, like, a job in the professional world anyway if I don't do this. So I'm really not losing anything. But even teachers in the program were just like, are you sure you want to continue with this degree? And so many students dropped out of the program, and they would just drop out because it, maybe they like wouldn't make candidacy or something. And then they would just go, you know, just be such assholes about it. Like, why am I going to study something that I can just do without a degree or whatever? And I'm like, well, fuck you. Like, don't bring me down for wanting to study it.
And also, but, like, I bet nobody who is like taking a fucking accounting course is going to be like, oh my God, I wonder if I'm ever going to be a professional accountant. Like,
yeah.
Oh, why am I taking this business degree? It's like, why? I mean, with the attitude that you're definitely not going to make money from it, you almost definitely won't in anything.
Yeah.
So it's,
yeah.
I mean,
totally.
Yeah. Do you know that there's a video game called Bully?
No.
The idea of the game is, you are a bully in the video game, and you basically just are in a school situation, and you get to be a dick. And
damn,
yeah, it's not great. Another childhood question: were you a kid that was bullied, or were you like a bully? I can't imagine that you were a bully.
No, I mean, I wasn't really much of either. I mean, I remember being bullied, but I feel like everybody was bullied. You know, like, you have all these insecurities when you're little, and you always, someone's going to call them out. Or if, I just can't imagine going, how do you get through middle school without being, like, embarrassed about shit? Or, like, you know what I'm saying? Giving shit about something. That just seems wild to me. So, I mean, I wouldn't say that, you know, I didn't walk down the hallways and had, like, paper wads thrown at me like you see in movies, but it definitely was, I don't know, I think everybody does to, like, a degree. But that whole concept as a band name was, the first song I wrote was called Bully, but it was, like, about being your own inner bully, because I think I bully myself more than anybody else. It's just, like, that constant negative voice in your head that's trying to tear you down. And I hate saying it because it sounds so corny, but it's true. And I used to get so paranoid about, well, everything in general, but particularly about, every once in a while I'll get a comment like, you know, bullying is bad. Like, you should feel bad for having the band name Bully. So-and-so happened to this kid for being bullied. And I'm just kind of like, if you honestly think that I'm, like, pro-bullying, you've never listened to a single Bully song. Like, you're insane.
I just like the idea that there would be a band that's pro-bullying. Like, that's a brave, that's a good hill to die on.
Or, like, the concept of, like, you all of a sudden being, like the name of your art project is such a weird thing. Like, I don't know, like Cage the Elephant. Like, are you guys really caging elephants? It's just so fucking dumb. It's like, I don't know. I just thought of them because they're a Nashville band, but I'm trying to think of other examples. It's just like an unfair thing to do. But whatever, it's dumb.
I often wish that I hadn't used my own name for my project. Like, I was so young when I started doing this, and I didn't think about trying to create a degree of separation between me as a person and me as a writer. It just didn't cross my mind. Because I also didn't think it would happen. Like, I was very unlike you in the sense that I was just competitive as a kid. Didn't really know what I wanted to do, but knew that I wanted to do really well in everything. So I just spread myself so thinly, was perpetually panicking from like the age I could write to now. I'm always like, oh my God, am I fucking up? Am I the worst? I really hope I'm not the worst. I hope my mom's proud of me. So yeah, I didn't put any thought into it, but I wish, I mean, it would be cool if there was an understanding between bands and fans where you could just like change your band name every record and everyone was just okay with it.
Yeah, like good band names are so far, like few and far between.
I've got a question about the future, which is not something that I really want to think about right now, so I'm putting a lot on your plate, but what is one thing that you would really like to see happen in the world before you die?
I would really like to see a blue whale. That's kind of like my goal. If I could see a blue whale, I would be so happy. I talk about it all the time. I think about it all the time. I would just freak out. But in the world in general, like what I would like to see everybody else in the world do. I mean, it'd be just cool if we weren't so fucking divided for once. Like if it'd be cool after this election, which I know probably isn't going to happen, that everybody was just like, using common sense to determine like what's best for everybody instead of just thinking about, you know, what's best for themselves, and that we could like work together a little bit, because right now everybody's just so mad at each other and everything. It's just like black and white and there's no in between and nobody's having like a conversation. They're just coming in with already like, you know, solid conclusions. And it would just be cool if we could not have so much hate.
Yeah,
I'm sure that's like a very broad answer, but we're just at a place where it's so, I think like everybody is just so motivated. I think what I would like to see in the world is just like mass empathy, like a little more. I think everyone needs to be a little more empathetic, because when I hear people argue about things, they're always just arguing about how their case and how it affects them instead of how it is affecting everybody else. And I think that you should have to consider everybody else as much as yourself. And I think there's just like a serious lack of empathy going on. And it would be cool if everybody could just have a little bit more empathy.
Yeah. I'm not sure whether it's a new thing or whether it's just more obvious that there's a lot of anger and selfishness because now we have the internet and there's like a billion news channels. But one thing that I think is potentially a positive to come out of this whole corona thing is that people who generally wouldn't consider the person behind them in a supermarket queue maybe now have just had that kind of drummed into them, even just wearing a mask. Like, I mean, maybe empathy is more easily accessible now because we all have to consider it every time we leave our house in a health sense. So maybe maybe it's on the rise.
But, yeah, it's just like, I was at a gas station the other day and there was two people not wearing a mask, and then there was like a very elderly gentleman wearing a mask. And I just wanted to look at those people and be like, it's not for you. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is for him. Like, or I was trying to think of if I was 85 and walking around and people weren't wearing masks, it'd be hard to not take it personally, you know?
Yeah.
It's just, it's not for you. Like, you're not wearing it. I don't care if you're 30 and you're healthy. Also, you could still get in a pretty beat up shape from it. But it's just like, it's not about you. Like, it's just, it's about everybody else who can easily, you know, has a weak immune system. And it's just like, yeah, that seems so obvious. Like, that's so obvious. And it's also just such an easy thing to do. Well, it's so easy.
It's become politicized, hasn't it? Like, wearing a mask is now almost a political statement. And I was watching this.
It absolutely is.
Yeah, there's a brilliant speaker on Instagram. I think their handle is Janaea the Future or something like that. And they're brilliant, and they do these Sunday services. And they were talking about how it's insane that wearing a mask is now a political point that you're making daily, because a similar kind of ilk of people, the people who are anti-maskers and making a point of it, 35, 40 years ago would have been the people that were protesting against compulsory seatbelt wearing. It's like, mm-hmm. And that literally using the exact same excuse, like, it's my body, it's my choice, ironically, probably don't say that in a situation where it's helpful. But yeah. Yeah, it's like, I mean, separately from seatbelts, though, like, if you don't wear a seatbelt, you're the only one that's going to die in a car crash. But if you don't wear a mask, like, I mean, yeah. It's
I
know what you mean about
crazy.
It feels a lot at the moment. I don't know about you, but I'm struggling to naturally feel positive, so I'm having to, like, force myself to see the positives in terrible situations. Like, I don't know. My overt positivity about potentially empathy being a repercussion of corona is me trying to force myself to not just stay in my bed and cry. I literally woke up the other day and immediately burst into tears because I knew that today was going to be the same day.
Yeah.
And that's not how I want to feel.
It's just so heavy. And then I also think that, like, the past 6 or 7 months or whatever in quarantine are really starting to catch up to people. Not that they haven't already, but just kind of thinking, touring's not going to happen for a year, you know? And it's just like, you start... I would love a little hit of that. Thank you. And I don't know, or at least for me, it's like, damn, it's been bleak, but it's, I don't know. I don't really know how to put it, all those thoughts into words, but is there something you want to see before you die?
I would, there's two things. There's an event that I'd like to see. There's this starling murmuration that happens in Rome where all of these starlings just make amazing patterns and dance in the sky at a certain time of year. And I think it would just make me cry, which would be nice. But going back to David Attenborough, there's a...
David. We love Dave.
David. Have you seen Schitt's Creek, by the way?
Oh, yeah.
The way that the mum says David. There's a David episode where they're focusing on, like, wildlife in urban environments. And at the end, he brings it back to what we can do to introduce wildlife back into urban environments. And in a few countries in the world, they're making an effort to, like, build buildings that have shelves where you can put trees. And, like, these tower blocks have suddenly become amazing sanctuaries for wildlife to come back and live amongst us as people. Wouldn't that be so cool to be able to, in 50 years, like, go to a city and feel like you're in a jungle? It's completely possible. I don't know why it's not more focused on, because it would be lush. As a person, to live in a city that's just full of trees, I don't know what the downside to that would be.
It's wonderful.
I
love it. I appreciate the trees in my neighborhood every day. I think, like, we just have a hard time realizing, and myself too, that, like, it's not ours. You know what I'm saying? Like, nature isn't ours, and it needs to be, like, left alone and respected. And the same thing, like, with animals and stuff. Like, I would love to go on a safari and be this close to wildlife and stuff, but I have to remind myself, I'm like, those aren't mine. Like, some things I just need to learn to, like, enjoy. And I think that we're just so used to being able to have everything and have it now. And then, you know, we're not even noticing like that we're slowly, it's like we're rapidly affecting the decline of that, you know, the longevity of trees' lifespans or everything else, which like we know about that, but
it's such I think it's such a strange character trait that we have as a species where to enjoy something we have to possess it, which kind of it spans like the world that we live in, but it also bleeds into the way that we see relationships, etc. Like I personally think that marriage kind of doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I don't know. But like the more that I speak to or read about like polyamory, for example, you can't expect to possess everything that someone else needs and vice versa. Like this whole idea of ownership is obviously just a human thing. Like no other animal is like, this is my shelter and you can't get in. Like if someone else wants to have it, they either kill you to get it or you share it.
I thought about that like a lot with cities when I was touring, because I would go to places and I'd be like, oh, this is, I love this place. This is my favorite place. And then I think I have to move here. Like I have to move here. And one day I just realized that I'm like, I don't have to live in a city to love it. Like I can love a place and not live there. You know, it doesn't have to be my goal to like exist there because it's so magical to me. Like, and ever since I kind of realized that, I feel like I mellowed out a little bit about like, I got to leave now. I got to live there now. My life is like going nowhere unless I'm in this city that I love. I'm like, no, you can love it just as much and just go visit it whenever you want or whatever, but you don't have to be in the middle of it to
I'm
love it or
about
appreciate
that
it.
A lot at the moment, like thinking about whether I would be happier during lockdown if I lived right next to the beach or if I could learn a different language from a friend next door. Like I have massive problems with permanence, I think. Like I'm in the longest relationship I've ever been in at the moment, and even that is like scary because I'm like, oh, I'm staying still, but it's really not like that. And the more that I have to let go of at the moment, like letting go of the idea that an album release should be exciting and people will kind of receive it in person and be able to, tour around and stuff. The more I let go of, the more I realize that permanence is not necessary. It's just a, I don't know. It's a, it's a thing that we can't afford right now and maybe don't really ever need. Like maybe that's another good thing.
Yeah, I mean,
to come out
of. It's not even really realistic. But I was going to say, I'm sure you're thinking about this a lot, or maybe not, but definitely now, since I know touring won't be happening for like another year or something, I keep thinking like, now's my time to go. Like, now's my time to like move somewhere, or now's my time to, you know, whatever. Obviously safely and like with a fucking mask, but yeah. And it's just like, you find yourself sitting still like that. It's just,
do you find it necessary to, when you get to the end of an album cycle and you think about writing another album, do you feel like you need to jumpstart the process by going away? And like, because I've been thinking about this now, like I've just released a record, I really feel like I need a week or a month in a completely different environment to collect myself and like restart everything. Do you ever get that feeling at the beginning of writing where you're like, fuck, I just need to go live in a cabin or like on a boat or something?
Yeah, for sure. I need to be just seeing things to be motivated, I feel like. And then it's, and then I feel like I'm thinking more about where I should go to look for like inspiration. Then I'm just like wasting time just like planning it out. I'll like get on Airbnb and like, wait, it's in the middle of nowhere, and then I'll get there and I'll be like, I'm scared, I want to go home.
Airbnb makes me so sad because I feel like I go in being like, I'll literally take anywhere that's like £40 a night, And then my priorities completely change. I'm like, well, I gotta have a bath. I gotta have a balcony. Yeah. There's gotta be a garden. Like, I start becoming really high maintenance.
If I don't have a waterfront view, this record is not happening. Yeah. Like,
and then I'm like, but what, so if the, what if the C's too loud and my vocals are interrupted? Like, I'm an impossible client on Airbnb.
That's so funny. It's so real. You're just like, well, then I'd have to bring all my gear. And then you're like, wait, I can't afford this anyway. What the fuck am I thinking? I always try and remember often, like, it's not about where I am. It's about, like, what I'm doing and what I'm surrounding myself with whenever I get the urge to leave. Mm-hmm. But I would just be so thrilled if I could be by any body of water, because it makes me feel so good.
Well, you are right now. I know your bath's not full, but it could be.
Yeah, exactly. My surroundings. I could put some moss in here and let it float around.
Oh, fuck yeah. There's an airport. I can't remember which airport, but they've got a living wall, like a garden that's on a wall and it's alive. It's incredible. Oh. And I remember, it must be an airport in England, because I went to LA, bought loads of like weed gummies and sweets and stuff, and then realized I couldn't bring them back home with me. So I just like ate them all before I got on the flight. And then I landed back home and I was so, so broken. And I was walking through departures and there was this live wall and I was like, oh, this is exactly what I needed. And just went up and was like, hello.
I think, can you not bring them back because of customs?
Yeah, it's still illegal here.
So, okay.
But I chickened out at the last moment. I had them in my guitar case and then freaked out and, yeah, ate them all. Whenever I say freaked out, I think of that kid who's like, have you seen that kid that's like, apparently I've never been on live television before and I just freaked out. I'm him. He's me.
So funny. Yeah, we've done like the, if you get like gummy peaches or gummy bears or something, just mix them with a normal bag and brought them through. Ugh. But I'm the same way though. I'll be like, what if I jeopardize the rest of my career?
Yeah, what if I'm back?
Just find weed back home.
I have a question about your mint green, is it a strap?
Yeah, well, it's like a Squire 51 body.
Because I've not seen, of all of the sessions that I've watched in the last 10 hours, I've not seen you play another guitar. Do you feel you're just committed to one instrument and anything else feels like cheating?
Yeah, well, that was given to you a gift. That was a gift to me when I first started Bully from the drummer who I was dating at the time. And it's just so special to me because it was like my first guitar that was my own, like my first electric guitar. And I have a bunch of other guitars and I just, there's like no point in me having any other ones because I'm just always going to play that one.
Yeah.
It's probably, well, I've done like a good amount of work to it through the years, but probably my least expensive guitar and like the only one I'll touch.
Yeah.
It just means a lot. I wrote all of Bully's stuff on it and it's just really special to me. So I don't need anything else.
Yeah. When you record, do you record with other guitars or your sound has become your kind of live sound even in the studio?
Yeah, pretty much. Do you play a bunch of other guitars?
No, well, I found this, my first electric I got in a charity shop in Dublin when I was on tour, like my first ever tour. And it's like this, I didn't know anything about guitars when I bought it. It just felt nice and it was cute and it had like a tiny little body. And I bought it and it looks like a telly, but I got it, what's it called when you get someone to tell you how expensive something is? Anyway, some guitar dude looked at it and was like, this is a Tele prototype called a Snakehead, which was made in like the 60s, and it's one of like 11 in the world, and I just happened to have it, which is insane. And I got given a Mustang but I always find a reason to get angry with the Mustang, because for some reason I know that the telly doesn't sound amazing. It sounds pretty crunchy and flat. It's a single pickup, so it's like you can't really do a lot with it. But yeah, it's like the shape of my hand has changed the shape of the neck, and it feels romantic. And the Mustang feels like I'm just playing a new guitar because I can. But when I was recording in Chicago, I did some guitar tracking at Electrical Audio, which I know you...
Oh, you did?
...interned at. Yeah.
Whoa!
So mad.
A or Studio A or B?
Ooh, I don't know. The one... The one, like, as soon as you come in the door, and it's got, like, a little booth, a little wooden booth through the glass. It's, like, just off the main corridor, the first left.
Was there a staircase in the studio? Like, I think you were an A. Okay. Who engineered it?
The producer that I was working with, Brian. But we did meet Steve, and I am not as clued up on music and the people within music as I should be. And Steve came in and was like, "Hey, I'm Steve. I'm here to like help you if you need help. Do you guys want a tea or coffee?" And I was like, "Yes, yeah, Steve, a coffee would be great." And then he left, and my bassist was like, "That was fucking Steve Albini. That was not someone you should ask for a coffee." And I felt really dumb. But how long did you intern there? Was it interning?
Were you working with Brian Deck?
Yes, I was.
Okay, cool. I was just interning there. It was like 3 months, but yeah, it was awesome. I learned so much.
Yeah. That pedal room, it was like, there's just any pedal you could possibly want. I got option anxiety. I couldn't choose. I ended up choosing one with like a naked cowgirl on, just because it felt like it was calling out to me. But I did play one of the like full like metal guitars.
Yeah, it's like 14 pounds or something.
I couldn't stand up, and I had like neck ache just from holding it on my shoulders. It was mental.
Dude, it's so heavy. I can go down such a pedal rabbit hole. Like, before I record every song, I'll try like every combination of pedals, even though I know what most of them do, and I will just like, I could fuck with that for hours. I'm always changing my pedal board. I love pedals.
If you had to just choose one pedal to use for like the next 5 months for playing, what would it be? Mm-hmm.
It'd be the Samson by Greer Amps. It's like a distortion pedal, but it's like pretty thick and almost a little muddy, but I really don't like high frequencies.
Yeah.
They really bother me. They like, I don't know, I can't stand them. And so I like how kind of like, how beefy it is. I love a beefy tone, bro. But yeah, do you have a go-to pedal?
I've got a pedal that my friend Ben made for me. It's got like a baby's face on it, and the switch is like in the middle of his forehead, so I feel kind of rude whenever I turn it on, like I'm stamping on this kid's face. But it's just like a reverb, and it's got some echo on it, but if you kick it, because it's broken, it does crazy like harmonics by accident. So that's my go-to. It's good. I'm not really into, I never really got kind of interested in gear or pedals. I don't know, I'm a bit switched off to it. I think because I write exclusively on acoustic and then go to electric to track and play. So I think I'm still in that headspace where it's like, unplugged.
If anyone asks me if I'm a gearhead, I'm like, no, absolutely not. But secretly, like, I'm not a gearhead. I feel like gearhead is a very specific type of thing. It's just like, I look at gear as like as a creative thing, just like how many things can I mess with and whatever. I'm not like online searching for things, but I love petals because I write with petals. I like use them from the beginning of the process, and they can really change a song and the direction of a song for me. And it's just, I feel like when I first started playing, having a distortion, and I had like this $50 analog delay that I got, it was like the first time I ever bought anything on eBay, just made me feel like I was like able to play electric guitar.
Yeah.
Because you can make anything. You could have a song and then you're like, this just isn't clicking. I don't know what's going on. And you put on distortion. You're like, there it is. That's what I was thinking. Like, that's what I was picturing in my head.
Recently found a video of like metal, people playing metal guitar riffs without any distortion. And it's so funny. It sounds
that
like...
is so funny.
It's like the tweeest, like surf kind of pop. It's so funny. I will absolutely send it to you. I just love the idea of like people hiding behind effects. Like that to me is hilarious.
Totally. That's me 100%.
But not for your voice. Your voice is just your voice, which I think is brilliant. You don't have any trickery. No trickery there.
That's
the thing I've ever said.
That's 100% real, baby. wait, have you ever watched the Shreds videos?
100%.
The Creed Shreds videos and stuff? God, that was like, you know, that was college. I was just like, would watch that all the time. I'm going to watch those tonight. They're so good.
When I try to not play just chords, I sound like I'm doing a Shreds of my own music. It's like horrible.
I had this like one solo in a song that was so easy. I think that's why I fucked it up. I would like think about it all the time. And it was so easy, like probably the easiest one that I had. And I would always fuck it up and it would sound like a Shreds thing. And I would always look at my bass player and just start laughing. So I was like, ever since I told him it sounds like Shreds, he noticed it. And if we were playing live and I would fuck it up, I would just look at him like, okay, there we go. I just don't even, yeah, I just don't fucking care anymore, whatever. Full of shame.
Do you have the same iteration of your band that you started with?
Oh, no.
Because I know that you write, it's just like a solo project that became a band.
Yeah. Not.
Wrong. Incorrect.
Yeah, actually, you're wrong. No, it's more of the opposite. I started it with like the drummer and stuff, but then had two people that were kind of in it for like a good amount of time. And then now it's just fully a solo thing. But the people that have been playing live don't play on the record or anything except for the drummer, which I've had for like 2 years. But no, it's always changing. I don't think I'll play with, I like kind of people who don't play on the record. I don't know. It just kind of like eliminates a lot of confusion, I think. But so it's basically changing all the time. Hopefully not. Choice. Hopefully for this record cycle, it'll be like the same group of people or whatever. It's not really changing all the time. It's not like a show to show thing, but there's different cycles.
Yeah. So yeah. Do you write the parts or do you get trusted people in to write their parts? No, you map all the instruments out yourself.
No, I do all the guitar parts and then songs that I write on bass, like Where to Start, Let You, and Hours. I like started writing those on bass, so I'll do the guitars and all the bass on those too. Mm-hmm. And then the other songs on the record, this guy, Zach, played bass on him and I just like sat down and kind of like went over all the parts and like worked them out together and then sent for drums. Wes will come over and then he'll just like be in my house working on one song for like 7 hours. I'll be like, try this. Okay, now go to the hat here. And then I'm like, actually just do what you originally did hours later. So
I have potentially difficult question to answer purely because every option I'm going to give you is really unattractive.
Okay. Go for it.
I know that now we all have very little to do. So I went on Craigslist in Nashville and looked for stuff that could take up some of your time. You have three...
You have... That's the nicest thing anyone's ever done for me.
I was like, she's not doing anything. You've got three options. The first option, the title of the first option is called Lost My Cleaning Guy. It says, need help at my apartment. I'm a guy that needs help. That's it.
Okay.
So I want to think that that's completely above board and like literally just he's messy and he's like got to the end of his tether with it. Make your own assumptions, not sure. Second option, weekend jam buds. This is my favorite one. Description, 60, looking for some non-inebriated jam bros. Weekend gatherings to hit a lick or two. Skill level is secondary to good positive vibes. I'm fully equipped with rehearsal space, Fender amps, PA, and plenty of time. Three chords and plenty of truth. Give me a holler if you want to plug in and crank it up. God bless.
I cannot handle this. This is like, that is Nashville. Like, when you were saying that, it was, I don't even know how I feel right now. It was like so cringy and unbearable. When I was ordering at the juice shop the other day, ordering a smoothie, the girl was singing very loudly to the A Star Is Born soundtrack, and it was just her and I in the juice shop. And it's like, obviously she's good, but like doing it to like try and get heard.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Shit like that happens everywhere in Nashville. You lost me at jam for that one. When it was like
from
weekend
the title.
Jam buds. I was like, that's done. I'm not doing that. You couldn't pay me. I don't give a fuck. I'm
I just love it because he's 60 and he included a picture in the ad, and it's a picture of him from the back at sunset with a guitar slung over his shoulder with an amp just next to him.
Oh yeah, I know exactly what that guy looks like.
I also love that he's like non-inebriated.
Yeah.
Like, I want you sober, I want your whole mind to be sharp, I want you to be on it. But you don't have to be that good, weirdly. Okay, and the third option is titled Free Whiskey Giveaway. I've got 30 cases of Jack Daniels and Canadian Mist to give away. Unopened, must call David. No emails.
He's got an ulterior motive there. There is no fucking way. Okay, I guess I would risk my safety and clean the apartment.
Yeah? You don't want to see what comes out of the jam?
I couldn't even handle you telling me that description. Like, I would lose my mind in that room. I can't express to you how I feel inside right now, but... And the whiskey thing, I mean, I'm sober, so it would be somewhat tempting. B, that guy's somebody's about to go missing, because that guy's got something else. Like, also, nobody's got...
Why does he have so much of it? 30 cases? Are you kidding?
Yeah, he just, like, robbed a fucking liquor store and is trying to not get busted right now. But... Yeah, I guess I'd be cleaning that guy's apartment. I mean, maybe I could make some money. At least I could make some money doing it.
Yeah, the other ones I don't think you're getting paid for. For sure.
That was so good. Wow. I'm very impressed. That was really fun.
I really like going on Craigslist. There's a section that's always lost and found. And I was scrolling through it earlier and there was someone that put up a post that just said, I lost everything 9 days ago.
Oh, that's the saddest thing ever. To think of them like completely devastated and being like, I'm gonna put this on Craigslist.
But it took them 9 days to like gather the courage to do it.
Yeah. It's so funny.
Like, I finally stopped crying enough to see the laptop screen.
Oh, that's so funny.
I've got a question related to receiving and giving. Oh God. Jesus Christ. I want to know what the best gift you've been given is versus the best gift you've given someone else. It's probably going to be your guitar though, right? I mean, I don't want to put words in your mouth.
I've got that's like the most meaningful gift that, like, that I've written every, like, I was saying this before, I said this one other time, and I'm afraid to say it again, because I don't want to jinx myself, but I try and not be attached to, like, material things. I mean, I'm still an American, so you know what I'm saying, but
you've got your,
like,
AirPods and your bathroom.
yeah, just, like, stuff that is a luxury, which is, like, whatever, even just having a roof over my head, but, if that guitar, if something happened to it or it got stolen or something, I would be really, really sad. That's like the one thing. That and my dog are like two things that, like, if something happened, I would be. That's definitely my only, like, material possession that would have any sort of, like, emotional meaning to me if it was gone. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna knock on wood, but yeah, I mean, I guess I have to say that only built meaning, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The best thing I've ever given, this is so badass, I'm very cool for this one. So there's this artist, Charles Forsman, that I love. He, The End of the Fucking World and I'm Not Okay with This were based off his comic books, and uh-huh. He's so badass, and my significant other's cat died. This was a while ago. And I commissioned Charles Forsman to make this painting of the cat with, like, a switchblade in his mouth. And it just says, "Rest easy, baby Jerry. See you when I get there." And it's like this badass painting. And he, like, gave it to me. I had it professionally blown up and framed and then surprised them with it. And it is an awesome gift. Like, that's if someone were to do that with me, if one of my animals died, I would just be, like, shook. It's so cool. And I still see it and I'm like, that is so cool. And we weren't even seeing each other for that long. But that was maybe one of the best gifts I've given. Oh, actually, I have one other one. My grandma and I are super tight. We're like, we're very close. And we were just like, have been together through some stuff. And when she was like, I stayed with her for like a month when something happened, and she would be like, put on Bully's CD and just like, she'd put on Feels Like, which starts with like a really aggressive song.
Oh, where you say the one with the line about masturbating?
No. This is the other record.
Okay.
And she would just like walk around the house and like hum to it. Like she just is like, oh, I love anything you sing, and it's so sweet. So for her birthday this year, I'm like, what can you get like your grandma? You know, it's like, you're never gonna tell me you need anything, and like, just material things that just doesn't matter to her, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I asked her for her three favorite songs, and then I covered them. Like, and it was like, I wish I could think of the songs, like the oldest songs ever, just very, and I did full covers of them. Like, one, I even did drums and everything. And then I like ordered a CD burner, burnt her a CD and like a case, and like decorated it and sent her that for her birthday. And she just called me crying. It was like, blah, blah, blah.
That is really pure.
Yeah, it was, that was a really good present. Also, I started those like, fuck, this is gonna take me so long. Yeah. Like, it's very hard to do that. It's not easy. And yeah, that was a good gift. That was
my nana is similar. She listened to my first record every night before she went to bed. And as a result, she hasn't heard like the last four or five songs because she just falls asleep really fast. But she'll always press play at the beginning and just let it play. And for this album, she was coming to a few shows last year. And she was like, I am worried that your next record is going to be a bit louder and I'm going to struggle to fall asleep to it. So off the back of that conversation, I promised her that I would record the whole album acoustically for her. And I've started it, and it's really difficult, but I'm doing it.
Oh my God.
And I think she's forgotten that I promised, which is good, because it could take me a long time. But yeah, having your nan appreciate what you're doing is something that, I feel like I'd feel a bit less supported if she wasn't, if I didn't know that everything I released, she's going to be the first one to be
on board.
It's cool.
Yeah, it's so sweet. It's
I love that she's humming it around the house.
She's literally just like sing, yeah, like humming it around the house. It's like super inappropriate. She's like, I don't care. Thank you. You're like, yeah, she's really sweet.
I feel embarrassed that I got that song wrong with the masturbation line, but I really like that line.
Thank you. It's
on Feel the Same.
Yeah, Feel the Same.
Yeah. Which, when I saw I think KXP or something, but the beginning, like live, it sounds different from recorded, obviously, because that's just what happens. But the live version sounded so much like Parquet Courts when it began, and it reminded me that I was in a Chicago bar when I was recording, and there was a guy reading a book at the bar, and I was like, that's Andrew Savage. That's 100% Andrew Savage. And I went over and, like, I don't chat people up, but I did because I thought it was Andrew Savage. And only just before we got into his house did I realize that it wasn't Andrew Savage.
Oh my, wait, who's Andrew Savage?
The guy from Parquet Courts, like the lead singer. Oh, and I was like, oh, well. But he was super nice. Like, he was such a nice guy. And I just purposefully wasn't bringing up music. So I was like, that would be so embarrassing for Andrew Savage if I asked him what he did, because I mean, we both know that I know, but it wasn't him. So that was fun. And I think when I realized, I like laughed out loud. We were just walking and talking about something else, and I was like,
yeah.
And he's like, what's funny? And
I'm like, I gotta go.
I can't tell you why I'm laughing. Terrible. Also, that was such a poor segue into telling my own story. Like, your music kind of reminds me of Parquet Courts. Anyway, I'm just going to talk about Parquet Courts.
No, I liked it. Those are my favorite kind of stories.
This is an easy question, I think. What's the worst thing you've bought online?
Oh my god. I took Ambien for like 3 years because I had a lot of sleeping troubles.
Mm-hmm.
And my favorite thing, I mean, probably till this day, if I'm just going to be honest, would be at the end of every day, I'd be like, okay, the day is over. I would take Ambien, get on my laptop, and then just shop. And I would just end up, like, packages would just show up at my door, and I would have no idea what they were, and I'd open them, and I'd be like, well, there's another Ambien purchase. Like, I would just stay up past the point where it's supposed to work. And then it was just like, all was like, anything was fair game. Like, I was constantly just getting in packages that, like, one day I opened a package and it was just like a rubber ducky. And I'm like, fair. Why do I have this?
Yeah.
Another day it was like fake nose rings.
Oh, rad. I went through a huge phase of wearing fake jewelry. I had a lip one. The port like this.
Oh my god, that would be so hard. That would be so distracting. But no, I can't. There's been some weird shit that I've bought. A bow and arrow, tap shoes. I mean,
wow.
Never too late, you know.
You know what? There's never a wrong time to learn a very specific type of dance that you need accessories for. I don't like tap for that reason. It's like, you gotta have the shoes. Hate that.
Gotta have the shoes. Yeah, a bow and arrow. I don't know, just fucking weird shit.
I almost blinded my brother's friend when I was a kid with a bow and arrow. Because my dad is a carpenter and he made us all our toys. Like, he even made me my lunchbox for school. My lunchbox was like an oak chest with like a fossil in the top. And I like lug it to school. Like, I had a really muscly arm at like 8 years old. But, yeah, he made us bow and arrows and crossbows. And my little brother's friend was around, and he just, like, poked his head around the door just as I was shooting an arrow down the corridor that all our bedrooms were off. And it got his eye just in the corner, and it was bleeding so much, and it missed his eyeball by, like, millimeters. And then, off the back of that, my parents were like, maybe just cars? And like dolls.
Yeah.
And also just doing it in the house.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bad.
Yeah. I remember a little rubber band shooters.
Oh, yeah.
Where you'd put, like, a pebble in it and just, yeah. Yeah. I mean, my bow and arrow doesn't really have a lot of force to it. I don't think it could even injure, like, a
worm.
A bird.
That's a good thing, though, because you love animals. Imagine how guilty you'd feel if you accidentally maimed a bee or something.
I would never. I could never.
Thank you so much for doing this, by the way. Do you have time for one more question?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, definitely.
I'm going to see what's good. I want to end on a positive note, but it seems like all my questions are quite grim.
What? No, I don't think so.
They're sad. Okay, I'm going to do a quick fire, and then I'm going to end on a real question.
Okay.
So, off the back of the fact that I know that you recorded on tape.
Mm-hmm.
This is an analog versus digital question.
Okay.
So, acoustic guitar or electric guitar? Acoustic being analog and electric being digital.
Electric.
For sure. Yep. Lace-up shoes or Velcro?
Lace-up, but I want Velcro.
Don't we all? With the light-up soles.
Oh, God, yeah.
Roll-ups or vaping?
Roll-ups.
Mm-hmm. I shouldn't be giving my opinion as well, correct?
You're like, yep, I agree.
This is one my boyfriend threw in the mix. Real life or Red Dead Redemption 2?
I don't know what Red Dead Redemption 2 is.
It's a video game, I think.
Real life, then.
Yeah.
Never thought I'd say that. Anyway, I think if it's a video game, it might just have more violence than real life, which is hard to imagine.
Just killing. Lastly, notes app or pen and paper?
Pen and paper.
I'm glad you said that.
100%.
Yeah. It's also so much more satisfying to, like, look back at a notepad rather than scroll through your phone.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't even really know how to work that notepad in my phone. I'm so pen and paper. Like, when I read lyrics, there should be no electronics by me whatsoever. And I just, yeah, I'm a pen and paper bitch for sure.
And I could tell that immediately. Is that a good or bad thing? I don't know.
That's the nicest thing anyone has ever said to me. I have not felt proud in a minute, and I am so proud.
You haven't felt proud?
I mean, I don't, you know, quarantine.
Yeah, I mean, we're all struggling, for sure.
Yeah.
Okay, my last question to you is, what gives you the most satisfaction in music? And conversely, what is always underwhelming?
Playing live gives me the most satisfaction. Playing live and hearing people sing your lyrics back to you is like the best thing in the world. And just like getting those messages in when people can relate and connect to them is really great. Underwhelming is, I don't know. What would you say for underwhelming?
Every time I release anything, I always feel whenever I release a record, I'm like, this one is going to make me feel like I've achieved something and I'm going to feel a little bit more complete, and it doesn't happen. And I think I should stop placing so much importance on like that day. But I can't help it. It's like a birthday. Like, I cried every single Christmas until I was about 15. Every birthday, every...
Me too!
Really? Like, every opportunity where you have to enjoy something, like, the expectation to enjoy it completely ruined it for me, and nothing would live up to the image of that day that I had in my head. Yeah.
Something with time markers, too. Like, New Year's makes me so sad, and I don't know why. Well, it kills me, but yeah, something, and Christmas too, it was like, but I think with Christmas, it was just like, I don't want this day to end. Like, I had so many cinnamon rolls and it was so good. But, I just remembered something really funny, but,
what did you remember?
Yeah. I would agree. I just remember one year for Christmas, like, me and my siblings found gifts before, because, like, obviously we did, like, we would see where they were hid sometimes. But I don't even think we intentionally tried to. They were just, like, under the bed, and that's where the wrapping paper was. But then, like, on Christmas Day, I guess my parents, like, forgot to, like, held some back. Like, I don't know if they were like, oh, we should, like, return these or something, but we had kind of already seen what we had gotten. And there was, like a disposable camera or something, some sort of, like, small camera that I had seen. And I thought I was opening it, and I was like, oh, I can't wait for this, this camera. And I opened it, and it wasn't a camera or whatever. And I saw my parents, like, look at each other, and it was just, like, little, like, we thought we were getting things that we didn't, which we were, like, totally fine. I mean, Christmas was never, like, let's open, like, a $500 gift, you know. It was just, like, little things. But I remember them going, oh, I think there is one, and Santa must have, like, forgot to bring it out. And they, like, snuck out the disposable camera and, like, put it under the tree. Like, it's just so funny as, like, an adult thinking about that, being like, and we could probably return a few of these things. And then a kid, like, thinking, it wasn't, like, a thing, you know. I wasn't, like, crying or anything like that at all, yeah. Or, like, being a brat. But it was just them kind of looking at each other like, oh, I think maybe Santa forgot to bring it out. Here you go. Here's the disposable camera.
I remember there being so many lies around Christmas, like, good lies. Like, when I got to the age where I obviously realized that Santa, I mean, wasn't real. I don't think anyone watching this will still think Santa's real, so I can safely say it. But my brother was still, he's like 3 years younger than me, so I was kind of trying to protect his innocence. And I remember, like, opening something from Santa and being like, oh, I love this music box. I just wish Santa was here so I could give her a big hug. I mean, him a big hug. And my mom was like, thanks. Like, across the room. All of these little lies and all this trickery is so weird. And I remember finding wrapping paper that Santa had used in my mom's sock drawer a couple of years before I figured out that Santa wasn't real. And I was like, what the fuck? This is exactly the same paper as Santa. Where did you get this paper? And she's like, oh, well, Santa only uses, like, local shops and, like, small businesses. He supports small businesses. And I got this, like, just down the road. And I was like, okay, makes sense. Like, Santa's a good guy.
That's so funny. I'm doing all of that when I'm older. If I ever have children, mm-hmm. I am doing, like, cookies with bites out of them, reindeer tracks in the yard. Like, I'm going all out. It's going to be another level. Like, we're mailing out letters to Santa. It's going to be the threat year round. It's like, if you don't clean your room, Santa's probably going to be pretty fucking pissed about
this. What is the adult equivalent of, like, knowing you need to behave because otherwise you'll get coal in your stocking? There's no adult equivalent of, like, year-long threat for, like, potential payoff of one day.
Yeah, it's just, like, people won't like you.
Yeah, it's just, like, you'll die alone. Like,
no one's gonna like you. So, don't you kind of feel like you hit a point, but, like, you get to, like, how old are you?
23.
Oh, you're very young. Okay. Well, I feel like you get to, like, a point where you're just, like, oh, holidays are, like, meant for kids, not in a way where adults can't enjoy them, but in a way where you're, like, oh, if I, like, I get it. Like, if I had a child, it would be so exciting. Like, Halloween, or, like, even Thanksgiving or Christmas. Like, I mean, I still, like, you know, enjoy them. I, not Thanksgiving, it's problematic, but but it's feel like you've hit a point where you're like, oh, I get it now. Like, mm-hmm. this is, like, would be so exciting if there was, like, a kid opening Christmas presents. You know, like, you kind of do all those things for it. So, yeah. Like, now I'm older and just, like, you know, I can whatever, just chill and still have fun and stuff, but
I feel like I'm, like, perpetually aware that other people would be enjoying something more than me, so I think even before I thought about maybe having kids at some point, I was like, yeah, probably kids that are 8, not 10, are enjoying this more. Like, I think it's always in my mind.
Yeah,
but for sure.
Yeah,
I have one friend with kids, and seeing them unwrap stuff. I gave one of them a guitar, just, like, the first guitar I had, and it's really crap, and I gave it to her, and her whole body was, like, shaking. I was like, oh my god, that's such a pure thing to watch, like, a kid just being, like, so excited that they can't even process like that. Yeah. That's better than opening something yourself. Unless it's a disposable camera, in which case that's fucking brilliant. Unparalleled.
So funny. Oh, I love this.
Have you seen that kid who opens an avocado and he's like, an avocado, thanks.
No! I'm about to look that up. That's so funny.
I've got so many links to send you.
Yeah, you should send me all of them. I want to see all of them.
An avocado, thanks. It's so sweet.
Thank you so much.
And the way he opens it is like he's opening like a live bird. He's like, so sweet.
Oh. The most delicate thing. So cute. It's really cute.
Thank you so much for doing Bath Time. I normally have the letters that spell out the word behind me, but I don't know where they've gone. It's been a while.
This is great. Yeah, thank you for having me.
It's weird that this has become like my social life now. I'm like, every week I get to talk to someone on the computer.
Yeah, totally. Like, you find yourself just kind of casually having conversation and interviews because you're like, you're the only person I've talked to in a week.
Yeah. I had an interview the other day that was meant to be 20 minutes and we stayed on the phone for like an hour and a half. And then she was like, this is actually really annoying because I'm going to have to like write all this out for my blog. And I was like, seems like a you problem. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oops.
Well,
sorry, I'm so interesting.
Good luck like that. Sorry, I'm so interesting. That's awesome.
Terrible.
Yeah, well, thank you for having me. It's been a joy.